Welcome to In Conversation. My guest today is talent manager Kyle Fritz. He owns his own management company. Welcome also to our studio in Australia, where it is 9 a.m. on a Sunday morning. Hello, Australia. Please send in your questions. We'll be taking questions from Facebook. We'll be taking questions from the studio audience here. And please like our page, share our page, and tell all your friends to tune into this chat. Welcome, Kyle, and thank you for making time to come to the studio.
Oh, thank you for having me.
We gave him a bottle of water. That was about it. Okay. First question is your own story. How did you get to this point in your life and career?
Well, I'm going to tell on you a little bit.
Okay.
A few years ago now, I was working at another acting studio in town, and I was forming my own little management company. At the time, it was a personal appearances company, and not very many people in Hollywood were dealing with personal appearances at the time. And I was putting all that together, and I was in the process of just going out on my own. And my husband, who's here today, was studying with Howard and found out he needed somebody to run his studio. And so, actually, the first time I ever walked into Howard's studio, I knew I was going to be running it. I don't know. Instinctually, I knew.
My level of incompetence?
He needs me.
Yeah, well, I did.
Howard asked to have a meeting with me, and I went to meet with Howard, and he said, I really want you to do for me what you've been doing for this other studio. I hear great things. And I said, yeah, you know what? I'm about to go do this management company thing, and I'm really kind of torn, because I'd love to do all the things that you want to do. You want to produce, and you want to do theater, and you want to expand your school, and then it's all great, and you have a great reputation, and you're exploding, and I want to be a part of that, but I want to do this other thing. And Howard did something really great for me that he said, don't ever let anybody take that business out of your hands. You come and you work for me, we'll work together, and you will create your business and you will create my business together. And that's what we did. And looking back on it, it's so important in this business to surround yourself with people who you admire and you respect, that have integrity, that are wanting to be successful, that have drive. And when you surround yourself, and those people want you to be succeed as well. And if you have that, if you're able to have somebody who lifts you up and you lift each other up, that's so valuable in this business. It's all relationships. There's so many relationships, and I have several Howards in my life. And you know, in this industry, we're a little bit different than most, because we have super high highs and we have super low lows. And if you don't have a good support group, people with level heads that you trust, that you can call and say, oh shit, the day I just had, or they're trying to get me to do this, what do you think? People that you can trust. And you know, when you meet those people in your life, your gut will tell you. Listen to your gut. Every time I do not listen to my gut, I am so wrong. So that became 3 wonderful years with him, producing, learning, meeting. We were at the height of our game. I've worked him like a dog.
He kept adding classes to my schedule.
I did. I even put these chairs together. I swear to God, I did. From IKEA.
You did. They're from them. And my desk.
And your desk. And so we did really well together. And then he was doing so magnificently at the time that I got to meet every new actor in town. I got to meet every casting director, because they were all calling saying, who do you got with new talent? And all of that lent itself for me to go, you know what, it's time for me to go and do my own thing, because I can't do both anymore. And Howard recognized that, and
well, thank you,
that's my story.
I did not expect that. When you meet an actor in your office, in the interview phase, what turns you on, what turns you off in that type of discussion?
Well, again, I did get to study with Sanford Meisner, and as well as a few other great acting teachers. I helped Howard with Uta Hagen. So I got to hone my instincts really well. I didn't become the consummate actor or performer, but what I did do was get really good people instincts and really good ability to assess the situation around me very quickly. So I actually make very quick assessments of people that are most of the time true. Most of the time I'm correct. So I look for, first and foremost, I look for people who I think are smart. Talent is first. First you've got to have talent, and then beyond that you've got to be smart, because unlike people in the White House, I don't want to be the smartest person in the room, nor do I ever feel like I am necessarily. This is a team sport. It takes a village to make this work. And I look at myself as the team leader and the team builder. I want to pick a good agent, I want to pick a good photographer, teacher, lawyer when it's time, publicist when it's time. So when the big decisions are being made, I need to be able to pick up the phone and have that team and have people that I trust that are hopefully smarter than I am.
So when they're chatting with you, what is it
I'm
in
sorry,
their...
Con-
no,
there.
That's all... Everyone's writing. It's all gold, so thank you. But just in that phase, how do you know they're smart? Does somebody come in sometimes and say, hey, I want to be a star, you should represent me, is that a turnoff?
Absolutely. I want people, when you come into my office, I want you to be able to have a very clear idea of who you are. And I think that's one of the hardest things as an actor and as a person to get. It took me years to figure out exactly what I was projecting to the world. And I think it's a really hard thing to figure out, but once you figure it out, if I ask you the question, what show should you be on? And you list 50 different shows with 50 different types of characters, I'm like, this guy's not in the real world. He doesn't know what he's selling. How am I supposed to know what he's selling? He doesn't know what he's selling. He doesn't know what his most direct route is. So I want you to have a very clear vision by the time you come to me of what the most easy and direct route is. So if I ask that question, where do you think you fit within the industry? And you say, I want to be a movie star. And I say, great, what movie would you like to be in? And you can't answer the question. Or which movie do you think right now that's out in current that you could have played that part better than the person who did it? If you can't tell me where you fit, then I'm a little hesitant, because I think you need to go out and figure out a little bit more about where you fit within the industry. So that's one of my first questions I'll ask. I also usually ask the age question, which I'm probably not supposed to ask, but I'll say, what is your age range do you think you play? And it's kind of a bit of a trick question, because people will usually hit their actual age at the high end and they'll say their low end. Typically, that's what people will say. So they'll say 17 to 27, I think, oh, you're 30. And not that it matters, because I will take on, it doesn't matter how old you are, if I vibe with you and we're vibing, then I'm going to represent you if you want to. But I want to know if you're in reality as to what you're going to play age range. If you are 35 and you look 35 and you say to me, I can play 16, I'm going to be like, yeah, you're not in reality. So somebody who's realistic expectations is very important when you come into my office. I want to feel like you're going to be realistic. You're not going to be asking me for things that are unrealistic that I can't deliver for you. There's just no... So that there's that. And then somebody I want to hang out with. Somebody who, I mean, we don't have to be best friends, but I want somebody who's going to be pleasant on the phone to talk to, or that we're going to have a plane ride to New York with for the upfronts, or, you know, we're going to be at the TCAs in Pasadena, the Talent Critics Association, for those that don't know what that is. And we're going to hang out for an entire day, and I'm going to spend a lot of time with you in a car. It's somebody that I want to root for, somebody that's going to root for me. That's what I'm looking for in clients.
Beautiful. We're taking questions from the live audience. From Facebook. If you have a question, please send it in. Please like our page, share our page. Australia, wake up. I want your questions. This is from somebody here, so if I say your name and you're here, please stand so Kyle can see who you are. This is from Sam Levine.
Hi, Sam.
You might as well stand, Sam. Do you have any advice for actors writing their own content? How would you advise a client to handle a script they've written and are passionate about?
Good question. Thank you. I think that you write, do everything creative you can, because sitting around waiting is hellish. So do everything creative you can. I just did this with somebody, and we shaped the script, and once we felt the script was ready, we had actors come read it, and then we called in a heck of a lot of favors to get it done. So I think what is really important about creating your own content is knowing when it's ready to actually be performed and put on camera, and then two, just working like a dog to get whatever resource that you have, to put all your resources together to make it happen. Ask me the question again.
How would you advise a client who wants to create their own material?
I would say absolutely create it, perform it wherever you can perform it. If it's for you and about you, find yourself some small theaters, perform it in your living room if that's what you need to do to hear it and develop it and get it going. I have a very successful client right now that is writing, she's on a series, but she's writing another series with her about her family. And she just had three of us come the other day into her living room and listen to it, and then had bagels and lox, and we all gave feedback, and it was really simple, and she's taking the notes and putting it together. So I think do as much as you can.
Sam would understand the lox reference. For others, it's smoked salmon.
Oh, sorry.
He's not Jewish.
Another thing I learned in Hollywood. So everything I say today, by the way, guys, is just my opinion. Nobody has the answer. Nobody has one answer. And anybody that does say, I alone can do it, you should probably run. Because, it's a team effort, and everybody's got opinions, and you want to work with people who are malleable and open to listening to new opinions. Our business is changing and moving so fast. It's very important that we not stay rigid in our beliefs and our ideas. There's no one path to any of it.
We're taking questions from Facebook and also from the studio live. This is from Sean, who's here. There he is.
Hi, Sean.
In your opinion, what is the climate right now for ethnic talent? How would you manage them differently, if at all?
I might have a contract in my pocket.
Does that mean it's a good time?
It's never been a better time for ethnic actors in this town. I think it's exciting and it's wonderful. It's a great time for diversity. I'll just try to, a little story from just this week. Extremely powerful, talented actress. Actor that has worked with her together for years. She requested, out of all the actors in town, that she have him on her new series. And they said, we love him, but we want to go diverse with all three male roles. So no. That's how coveted the ethnic card is right now. People are wanting diversity. So if you're a diverse talent in any way, make sure people know it. Make sure you put it out there. This is a great time for you. For the white people out there, it's making it much more difficult to develop a young white talent. You should just know that. And, the scales have turned. So, yes, the answer to your question is a great time. And hustle like crazy right now, because we don't know when that pendulum will swing back.
This is from Facebook. At what stage of an actor's career should you have a manager?
Now here's another place where my answer has changed over the years. I think you should bring on... This is from Facebook.
Yeah.
I think you should bring on a manager right away now. I think agencies have gotten really big, and the really good boutique agencies have shrunk to such a small amount that if you don't have a manager advocating for you in your corner, the chances are you're going to get lost. So I suggest that you get a manager early.
Would you do that before having an agent?
Most of the time, yes, because you really want, again, I'm the team captain, that's the way I see myself. I want to hire the team. I want it to be people I like. I think one of the biggest jobs a manager will do for you is hire your first agent. And you want it to be somebody that they click and gel with, if possible. It doesn't have to be, but if possible, you want somebody they work with. Now, a lot of times people will come to me and say, my agent's not getting me out. I don't know where my career is going. I need help. my first instinct is never to just fire everybody. My first instinct, because again, I alone don't know everything. I want to get in. I want to see what the agents have been up against, what the people have been up against. Maybe sometimes I spark something in somebody that like, oh, Kyle's interested in him. Maybe we're not working hard enough. Maybe I can direct them a little bit. So I try that route first. And then if I feel like, oh, this guy's not really pulling his weight, I need somebody better, then we'll make adjustments. But my first thing is not to always just burn down the barn. I want to see what I can do to help enhance the team that already exists. But I do think you need a manager in this day and age to start. And it is better if they have a good relationship with the agents.
Right. We're taking questions from the live audience and more from Facebook. Oh, this is interesting. This is from Facebook. It's from a fellow manager.
Oh.
Okay. This is from Brian Medavoy.
Oh, Brian.
Hi, Brian. Who has done the In Conversation. It was Brian that kicked off the In Conversation series. So thank you for your question, Brian. It is. What are the biggest challenges you face? What's something you wish you could tell actors but can't? Brian. What's something you wish you could tell actors reps but can't? Oh, are you trying to ruin a colleague's career?
Yes. By the way, Brian's also one of the ones that they wanted me to get rid of my personal appearance business. So.
All right, so the first question is, what are the biggest challenges you face?
I think one of the biggest challenges I face is, it goes back to what I was talking about in this being a very high and a very low business, is to stay as centered as I possibly can. Because at any one minute, I am calling you with a television series and telling you didn't get one. So it's really, it's bipolar a lot of times. So I think keeping myself level is probably my personal biggest challenge. I am pretty blunt in my life and in my demeanor. So if you're working with me, you know that in advance because we'll talk about it. And I'm going to pretty much not shield you from much. I'm going to pretty much tell you, unless I think it's really going to pull down your self-confidence, I'm pretty much going to tell you straight out what's happening because I'm not a very good liar. So
haven't I taught you anything?
No.
And he wants to know what's something you wish you could tell actors reps but can't.
Do what I say.
All right, I'm going to move you on to safer ground.
Yes, thank you, Brian.
Headshots, are they still important, and what makes a good headshot?
They are absolutely important for the new talent, at 100%. And as you're going through the business, it's important that your headshot sort of stay at somewhat current. Once you're a name, it's not nearly as important as it was. What do I look for?
What do you think is a good headshot? What makes a good headshot?
It changes all the time. Well, of course, it's color now. I mean, I prefer black and white back in the day, but that's not happening anymore. So it's got to be color. And you know, it changes with trends. I prefer a nice tight headshot. Now, if you are a very athletic person, or it depends on what you're selling, actually, a lot. Because if you've got a nice athletic build, and that's what we're going to sell, is we're going to sell you as the soldier, as the trainer, as the bodyguard. We're going to use your body type. Then you're going to need to show that in a picture. So then I'd say, let's go 3/4. Let's do something in a tank top, maybe. And if you're a beautiful woman, I might want a 3/4 of your body. If we're going to sell you as a sexy woman in this business, then I might want that. But most of the time, I prefer just the nice, tight headshot.
Okay. And what about resumes? Is there a form you prefer?
Well, if you're with my company, then we I don't know that everybody else does this, but I take in your resume and I take it over. So you will never have to update another resume. I have my own personal format that I've used for years.
So could you give an example of what that is for people who don't?
Well, it always starts with film, and then we go with television, and then we list theater, and then we list training, and then we list special skills at the bottom. Special skills have actually become more important now than I think ever, in my opinion, because when they're looking for specialty players, or if you can do a British dialect, or and you have that little thing, they'll see that and they'll bring you in because you can do something that somebody else can't do. So if you can do the unique things, especially dialects, if you can really, and I mean really do a dialect, like if you're really, really great at a British dialect, put it down. It's important for people to, when I'm selling you out there and they're like, well, we want somebody who's really British. I'm like, they are really British. And they're like, well, it doesn't say so on the resume. So, you know, it's great if that's on there. If you ride a horse, anything that's going to take you just a little bit different from everybody else is good to know.
Great. We're taking questions from Facebook, from the studio live here. Please like our page, share our page. This is from Facebook, an Australian, but she's in LA. Stephanie, what's the smartest thing an international actor visiting Los Angeles can do to connect with their first manager?
Show up with a green card. Really. I literally, before I came here, ran into a casting executive of one of the big studios, and we were talking about stuff, and he said to me, you know, this year, because of what's happened with our government shutdown, we're not even trying to hire the English and Australian actors. There's no time. We can't. The visas are so backed up that there's no way they'll get a visa in time for them to shoot next month or in the next 2 months. So they're not even looking at those people because of that. Mm-hmm. So really, when you get here, you need to try to get that part solved, and that's a really tough thing for people that are from here.
And following off of that, what's a positive way to stay in contact with you? What's a negative way? What would you frown upon?
I like people checking in with me from time to time. I do. When you have a great, it's always an email is best. And to say, hey, you know, we met through so-and-so, and you needed more credits from me, or you needed me to have more training, or so here's a little scene I shot of an audition I had the other day, or give me something that has changed from the last time we've talked that's interesting. I don't have time to just say hi. So if you're going to approach me with something that you're exciting that's going on in your life that you're doing.
Has that worked out in the past where someone stayed in contact and eventually you
100%.
Them?
100%. Somebody I'm really excited about right now, I said no to twice before I signed her. She's now on her first television series that just got picked up for season 2. And so, yeah.
So there's a positive way, but you have to have something to be in contact about. I'm doing this, I shot that.
Yeah, and then sometimes tenacity does pay off. Sometimes the squeaky wheel does get the grease. If you're like, I had an actress once, and I don't recommend this, but I had an actress once who came to my office who I actually had met here, who I thought was one of the most talented actors I'd ever seen in my life. But at that time, her look, everything about her did not seem the most marketable person at the moment. And we also had a lot of mutual friends. And she came into my office and she said, you are going to represent me. And I said, no, I'm not. And she said, yes, you are. And this is why. And she laid out all of her reasons, which were all great reasons. And I knew that her husband was a headshot photographer. And I thought, this is going to kill it. I said, you know, I got to be someplace. So get in the car. Let's continue talking. So we got in the car. And I said, you know, you've made a good point, and I would do it, but I don't want your husband to shoot your headshots. So I don't think this is going to work out. And she went, fine. I'll get somebody else. And she ended up being one of my favorite success stories. She's had a terrific career and worked her tail off, and it would have been a huge mistake to have not represented her.
All right. This is from Matthew, who's back there. If one has the ability to grow a beard, I think he's asking for a friend, to grow a beard rapidly, what would you suggest to said client for headshots, especially when there are many possibilities for both clean-shaven and bearded roles?
That's an easy one. Take a razor to your photo shoot. Take both shots and give me both options. So that's, yeah.
Should he go around in general with the beard since he can shave it off fast?
Yeah. I'm a huge believer in you feeling the most attractive and confident that you could possibly feel. And if the beard makes you feel confident and attractive, then you should wear it every day. But if I ask you to shave it off because then you need to just be willing to drop it, you know? That's my answer. You're in a better position than a lot of people because most of the time I hear, oh, I've been working on this beard for 7 months.
No,
yeah, my assistant in the back, we have this discussion all the time. And And, you know, they don't want to shave it off. And I'm like, you need to for the audition. You absolutely cannot play this role of being Howard. Although that's not, nowadays everybody's kind of sporting some facial hair, so it's not as big of an issue as it might have been 5 years ago. So.
Great.
Thank you. We're taking questions from Facebook, from the studio audience here. Please like our page, share our page, and tell everyone you know to tune in to hear talent manager Kyle Fritz. This is from Jana Wiltz, who's also an Australian, who's
Hi.
Here.
Hi, how are you?
Great, how are you?
Good, thank you.
In Australia, we have agents, only agents. What is the difference between an agent and a manager, and which should I focus on securing first?
Well, this is always a tough question, and the answer gets more difficult every time I answer it. I think I answered my opinion on the first part of the question already.
Well, then she asked us another one. So.
No, right. I'm following up with the difference between an agent and
a
manager. Okay. So the lines have gotten more and more blurred between an agent and a manager. Primarily, the agent's job should be to get you appointments and get you opportunity, and the manager's job should be to shape and guide the career as a whole. And be aware of what projects are out there that are right for you. And hopefully be able to help point your agents in that direction. That's in the perfect world. That doesn't exist as strongly as it used to. We must, as managers, be out there submitting. We must, as managers, be out there looking for work for our clients. We must be making pitches in parking lots, which I just did a few minutes ago. I mean, it was very organic. We were aroused. I think that you can't, a long time ago somebody told me 10% of nothing is nothing. You can't afford to not bring on the biggest and best team that you can create around yourself. Again, it takes a village, it takes a team. And if you've got people who are connected and excited and passionate about you, then why wouldn't you bring them on? And people that you look at and you go, ooh, I want some of what that person's got. That's what you're looking for in your representation. You're like, ooh, I like the way he carries himself. I like the way he represents me, would represent me. I like the way he speaks. I like whatever it is that's attracting you to that person. Then you should think seriously about bringing them into your team. Certainly when you're talking about agents and managers, then when you get into the level of needing or wanting an attorney or a publicist, those are bigger discussions that you'll have with your agents and your manager. When's the right time? Are we doing the right project to bring on a publicist? Is it even worth this fifth role on a series to pay $5,000 a month for a publicist right now? Can we get enough attention on our own? Or are they going to add to the team or not? So, again, it's just it's a team.
Jan asked a second question, which our studio in Australia, if you're awake, will be interested in, and it's, with the prevalence of actors being cast with their native accent in TV and film, how important is it to have a U.S. reel when seeking a manager or agent, should you have your American accent on that reel?
I think it's very important that your reel show every bit of your diversity. So, I mean, if you've got a reel that shows you with a great American accent, and I mean a great one, then send it to me. I want to see you do an American accent. I want to hear how good it is. I have a really good ear. I want to hear your American accent. As well as I want to hear your Australian.
That brings up an interesting question for auditions. Should they go in, if they've got a role that's American accent, with their original accent and switch, or should they go in the entire time with the accent that they've been cast for?
Well, so, wait.
In other words, if you're Australian, do you go to the interview and chat a bit with your Australian accent and then switch to the American for the audition?
I would. I mean, I would, because I think Americans are completely enamored by the Brits and the Australians. So
that's why I have a studio in Australia. We are. We love the accent.
We love it. We love it. And when we see that you can flip it out, then we're like, whoa, you know, it's like a magic trick.
That's great.
So that's my opinion on that.
Okay. This is from Facebook. What are your core expectations from your clients?
Ooh. preparation, preparation, preparation. I don't want you. I need you at a drop of a hat to be able to stop what you're doing and be completely prepared for whatever I'm throwing at you. Which is, can happen really fast, especially right now in this time. So I need you to have either a really good coach that will put you on tape and let you self-tape. I need you to have like 3 or 4 of those in your back pocket. I need you to be ready to be off book in a notice. And by the way, that's another thing that's changed. I used to not be a fan of pushing off book. Now, I do not think you can afford to not be
off. I so agree with you.
And
they
so,
know that.
I mean, hold your sides in your hand. Definitely make it look like this isn't a polished performance, but you don't need them. Don't need them. Keep it for an emergency. So I need to know that you are going to know to be prepared for them. Because you may get out just once a month. But I need to know that you're ready to get out once a month, that you're going to be ready to go get that job. And I'm here to help you. If you say, shoot, I can't get into Howard for a private coaching in time, or whoever's going to be putting you on tape that we're used to you using, I'll make the call and I'll say, hey, it's me, get him in, you know, or whatever.
Yes.
Whatever, you know.
All right, 6 a.m. Okay.
I make hair appointments for my clients. I will build your chair. Whatever it takes. Whatever it takes to win.
That's fantastic. This is from Parker, who's here. Where are you, Parker? There he is.
Parker.
Do you see theater? If so, is it something you would use as a decision maker when looking at a potential client? And how important to you are theater credits?
I see everything that opens at the Taper and the Amundsen, pretty much for the most part. I occasionally would go to Pasadena Playhouse. I don't go to a lot of small theater, and there's a reason for that. It's because Howard and I used to produce a lot of small theater together, and it was a lot of work. And I enjoy the spectacle of theater. I enjoy big musicals. I enjoy, but if somebody says you have to go down and see this person in this play, he's just phenomenal, I will go do it. Or if a client is doing something in a small space, I will go see it. But it's not my preference. But if you are so good in a play that you think, boy, if you see me in this play, you are gonna want to sign me, then, and you can convince me of that, I'll go. I will go. But I'm not gonna lie and say I go to all the small shows. I don't. I do go to all the big plays in town.
So something's getting word of mouth or somebody you trust.
Yeah, if you called me and said, Kyle, but I got this student who's brilliant and he's brilliant in this play.
And they're in a play. Yes,
yeah.
It's because there's something you can see.
Right.
Right. Because you have to have something that you can evaluate.
Yes, but I will look at it. Like, I will look at I'll look at an audition. I have no problem watching you self-tape something that you were up for and showing it to me, and you say, this is one of my best auditions. Look at it, because that tells me a lot. If you think that's one of your best auditions and it's not, then I'll make an opinion, or it is, then I like, oh, this person knows what they're doing. So I'll look, I'm open, for sure.
That's great. We're taking questions from Facebook here, some coming right now. We're taking questions from the audience live here. This is from Brittany, who's here, there she is.
Hi, Brittany.
In your experience, what single trait do you find common in most successful actors?
The most successful actors that I have known have a very strong vision for what they want, and a very strong sense of self, and they don't deviate much from that plan. That's what I've noticed about people that really get what they wanted, that really have won an Emmy, that are winning Oscars, they were very, very focused, like, I want this film career, and this is how I'm going to get it, and they knew what their strengths and their weaknesses are. So. Very strong focus and a very big willingness to be prepared and put the work in. I mean, I had an actor that would come in to self-tape himself, who's very famous right now, and
Oscar nominated?
Maybe.
Yeah.
And
he's bitter.
he would spend hours in my office putting himself on tape, and I'd be like, I gotta, and he was so focused. So, yes, I think a really strong sense of self and focus is really important.
Great. We're taking questions from Facebook, from the studio audience here. Send them in. Share our page. Like our page. And this is from Aziz, who's here. Are you okay? Do you prefer to sign talent that already has credits, somewhat established, or someone friendly, brand new, and green in the industry? Asking for a friend. Bearded friend.
I'm at a point now that I do prefer people with client with credits. Unless you are super young and haven't had the opportunity yet, but I am in a place where, you know, credits do matter to me. It allows me to see more of your work. It allows me to see who's responding to you within the industry. So I do prefer that at this point in my career. I was a lot more open to that earlier. But more and more I'm looking for actors with good credits.
Although would he fall into the ethnic diverse category?
Well, that was my next yes. Yeah. a lot is forgiven in the ethnic diverse category. It's true. So, yeah.
This is from our own Ian Cardone, who occupies a position you know. When did you know you wanted to be a talent manager, and what continues to inspire you?
Great question, thanks. I never knew I wanted to be a talent manager, per se. I was an actor, and this goes back to what I was saying when we started. I listened to my gut, and I would find myself in positions like in the middle of Howard Fine's Christmas Party going, oh, I'm gonna run this studio. And listening to that and just kind of following my journey where it took me to where I ended up becoming a talent manager. I also married an actor and one of us had to make money. it turned out all right, he's had a few series. I really am a big believer in listening to your gut. I think your gut will lead you in the right path almost every time. And I think, so for me, it just fell in. And like I said, when I was working for Howard, I got to meet all these young, wonderful actors and all these casting directors. So then they were all asking me to take on their career. So it just took on a life of its own. So that's how it happened for me. And that's what led me. I never sought out to be a talent manager. It wasn't something that I planned on doing. And then I thought about going to work for somebody else, Brian. And again, I listened to Howard.
I said, don't go work for Brian. Don't work for Brian. That's where careers go to die. I love you, Brian.
But Brian didn't want me to keep my personal appearance and stuff. So I was like, yeah, I can listen to Howard. What still keeps me excited? Is that what the second part of your question?
What inspires
me? Great performances every day inspires me. The changing of this business inspires me. Like I said, I was talking about her earlier. Watching an actress she had tons of training, MFA. Watching her go from nothing to a series regular on television where she's just thriving and is making this, that's exciting. Every time I help somebody land a job, that's exciting. Because every time I do it, I think, gosh, am I going to do it again? We're not any different than you guys are, really. Like, you always think it's going to be your last job, right? So every booking, we feel like, oh my God, this is the last one. the work keeps me inspired. That's what I love about what I do, is I love actors, and I love the craft of acting, and I understand it, and I know how hard it is to give an authentic performance with somebody else's words, and I just, when it happens, when you see it in front of you, you can't deny it, and it's just so exciting.
Great. This is from Linda, who's here. Okay. No, this is a sad one. Tell us one of your worst experiences as a manager.
I'm not talking about it.
Bitter party of one.
I'm not talking about it.
I never answer when I get asked, who's the worst person you ever talked to? We still want to work. Okay.
True.
Okay. This is from Facebook. What is your approach to representing actors who do not reside in the USA, developing them, and does it differ to the way you work with local US-based actors?
I don't typically, where is this coming from?
This is from Facebook.
Facebook. I don't work with a lot of people who aren't living here in the United States. I've worked with several people who have come here from other countries and helped them along and helped get the visa and helped establish that. But I don't even want to work with people that are out of state, really. I want you here with me or in New York, where everything's happening.
That's, have you found talent overseas that you've helped bring here?
I have not. I have had talent from overseas find me.
I see.
Usually they're out of Juilliard or some of the bigger schools, and they've come from other places, and I've signed them from there. But no, I have not. No.
Okay. This is from Max, who's here. There, okay. What stands out to you when you are deciding whether or not to take on developmental clients?
I feel like I kind of have said that, but I'll say it again. It'll be a gut instinct of somebody I want to be around, somebody that I like, and somebody I feel has it together, and somebody that has a strong sense of self. I'll tell you what I can say that might help you. So many of you come in to see me, and you're so afraid of being typecast. Or, you know, I had an actor years ago that said, I want to do everything, but I don't want to be on a soap opera. And guess what I did? I put him on a soap opera.
He won two daytime Emmys. He came out of here.
So, yes, he did come out of here, actually. And don't be afraid to be pigeonholed. Don't be afraid to be typecast. As a matter of fact, get typecast. Tell us how to typecast you, because once you're in the door and you become a name, they're going to let you do whatever you want. They are.
I agree.
So get in the door, whichever is the most direct way in the door, get in there and let us typecast you, and then let's work out of it.
Now, how much work do you have to do to be known for anything?
Right.
A lot.
Exactly. A lot.
We're taking questions from Facebook, from the studio audience here. They are coming in. Okay. This is from Facebook. It's on the flip side of an answer you gave. How can a non-diverse up-and-comer stand out for potential representation? What is it for you that would make you say yes to taking on a non-diverse client?
Man, it is just so hard. It used to be so much easier to answer that question. I would say it's the very same answers I'm giving. I still give it. If you've got something that's different from somebody else, or something that's extremely appealing, if I think you have a great charismatic factor, if you come from somebody like very that I respect a lot, and they say this person's going to have a career, you need to sit down with them, then I'm going to listen to the people that I listen to in this business. So if one of the producers or directors or Howard or somebody comes to me and says, this kid's got it, I'm going to listen to that, and I'm going to make my own assessment. So that's one way, is to get a great recommendation from somebody who's got credibility in the business. I'm always willing to try. It just sometimes can get very frustrating. In fact, I've had a couple really great, talented younger white guys lately that I just couldn't get seen. I couldn't do it. No fault of theirs and no fault of mine for trying. It just was not happening. And
off of that, is there a time of year that it's better to approach you than
great
not?
Great question. This is the worst time of year to approach me. I'm getting five or six emails a day from people, and I will flag the email and put it aside, because I do try to look at everything that comes through my office, but I also usually make a really snarky comment, like, aren't they paying attention to what's happening in the industry? This is not the time to catch somebody on my side of the table's attention, because we're so focused on what's out there. The best time, I was thinking about this morning, I think sort of the best time is like right before the holidays hit. People are sort of getting it, like I'm talking October, November. People are starting to get in the mood, it's toward the end, and they're more open to maybe seeing people. Sometimes in the summer when it's slow is a good time, but never end of January through March. Just don't even send your stuff out. I think it makes me think, oh, they don't understand the business, because they wouldn't be sending their stuff out right now.
Great. We're taking questions from the studio audience here, from Facebook Live. Send us your questions. Australia, wake up. Like our page, share our page, please. This is from Facebook. It's a follow-up to another question you answered. Off of working with out-of-town talent, is it a strength for an actor to have connections to other U.S. markets, relationships with casting directors in Atlanta, Boston? And I'll add to that, would you ever think it's wise for an actor to be willing to pay their own way to be a local hire if they have a chance at a job?
Yes. The answer to that question is yes. Depending on what the job is and the cachet this show has, I would have answered that question so much differently a few years ago, but it's getting more and more difficult. So yes, if you have to pay for yourself to fly, depending upon the role, and that you think we can do something with it, if it adds to your tape, if it adds to your resume, if it gives any kind of a boost, yes, I think it is. It's not a preference, clearly, and if you have good representation, they will absolutely try to fight you having to do that. But we will acquiesce if it's the right job. Question before that was?
I have to find that.
Do I think it's important for other markets?
Yeah, to develop relationships with.
Yeah, I do, but I haven't had very much success with it, to be honest. I've had a few people who have Atlanta agents, and a few people, and I have not been that successful with that. A couple jobs here and there, but I think primarily it's all still being generated out of New York and LA. It really is. I mean, except for the smaller roles, the co-stars and that shoot in Atlanta and those kinds of roles, and that's not stuff I'm really focused on, and I don't feel like that's stuff that you're going to want to pay your own nickel to go do. So unless it's real easy for you to get to Atlanta, I wouldn't make that a big gold focus on your. Now, I do know actors, and somebody who I love very much has moved to Nashville, and she was working, I talked about it earlier, she worked crazy, and then it kind of stopped for her a little bit, and she's like, I'm done. She moved to Nashville, and now she's the queen of the theater in Nashville. She's doing amazing jobs, and all these amazing writers, huge, huge writers, playwrights are coming out, and they're writing stuff for her. And she's now, she's winning awards, and she's having the time of her life. Her house is paid for. Like, it sounds like a nice life. So if you're gonna focus on those markets, if you're gonna think about, then go do that, I think. That might be the better answer.
Okay. This is from Facebook. Do you consider social media and followers when you are deciding to represent, and also, does it factor into the casting process?
Those are two different answers. I never look at somebody's social media. I mean, unless somebody presented to me as this is a social media star, then I would pay attention to it. But when I'm looking clearly at your talent level. I really am. I'm looking at that. I don't get excited by Instagram. But that being said, I do know when you get down to when you're playing in the big league, they will look at how many eyeballs you can help them bring to their channel, and they will look at your feed. But I think that's at an upper level. I think that's at a level of a name actor, whether when they're deciding, you know, between give me two actors,
Brad Pitt and Leo DiCaprio
and Bradley Cooper. Brad Pitt and Bradley Cooper. They'll look at, well, who's got more? Probably not. They're probably both too big. When they're looking at and when I say name actors, people who have had success in Hollywood, and they're trying to decide who they're going to choose between one or the other, I think they will look at your social media.
Can you get an actor back in after they've blown an audition?
Yes, I can. But if I do that for you, it better be drastically different than what you did the first time, and you better nail it, because nobody wants to see you come give the same audition again badly. Nobody wants to see you do that. So if you're going to get a second at bat, and you're going to really push for one, because I have actors who go, please just get me back in the room, and then they go and they give the same performance, you make us all look bad. So if there's something that you can drastically do differently, and I mean differently, then there's no point in you going back in. What I will say to a lot of you is put it on tape and let me show it to the casting director and see if they think it's any different. So that's probably a better option.
you get involved with wardrobe selection, with hairstyles?
You know, it depends on the client and what they're doing. Every client's different. I have some clients that want me to, like, I am literally naked with them in their closet. Well, not me naked, but they're naked.
This is not the moment to make such a statement.
Yikes.
Oh, dear. You meant that in a theoretical way.
Yes. I'm in the closet picking out clothes. They're trying them on. I'm not watching. And getting ready for, you know, a big photo shoot or a big press junket or something like that. Somebody will call me and say, what do you think I should wear for this? And I'll have an idea, you know, put a tank top on or wear a suit or wear a tie. You know, I do get involved with some of I get those questions a lot. What do you think I should wear to this? And I'm like, well, as a lawyer, put a suit on. Yes, I will get those kinds of questions. I will get involved
in those things.
Yes.
Do you want your clients to have several different types of headshots with different looks?
No. So that I think one good headshot is all you really need.
Okay. Yeah. When a client is not clear about who they are and they're pressuring you, why am I not in for this? Why am I not in for that? How do you deal with that?
It's tricky because it's...
Do you want them looking at the breakdowns and telling you what they should be seen for?
No, I mean, yes. Actually, I do. I want you to know what's out there. But I want you to be able to be realistic about what you're right for as well. So if you are looking at the breakdowns and you come to me and say, why can't I go in for the new Katie Keene pilot? All my friends are going in. And I'm like, well, they're all this type. Or they're all... If you're going to ask me for something that I can easily see, I need to know... that it's either, you're right, you should be in, you should be seen for this. You're absolutely right, I'm sorry I missed it. Or there needs to be something I don't know about you that would help you get that job. Like something ethnic in your background or a dialect that you can do or something that I may not know about you that you would say, hey, you don't know, but I have this background. Which makes me really right for this, you know. Those are the kinds of things that I go, oh, wow, I didn't know. Let's make this happen. So do I want you to, you know, I had an actress send me a self-tape the other day, unsolicited. And she did it, and I sent it in. But I didn't just send it in unsolicited. Once she'd done the work, I thought, I'm going to call casting again and see if they won't watch it. And they said they would. But I don't like actors just assuming they're just going to send me a self-tape and I'm going to send it to casting. That's not kind of the way it works.
Okay, this is from Nicole, who's here, who's one of your clients, I believe. Can you share your thoughts on craft versus personality? That is, the worth of developing craft versus selling your personality or look.
I think it kind of all is one. I mean, you're expected to have the craft. That's all. That when you walk through the door, they expect that you can act. You've gotten that far. So... And then the personality on top of that is selling yourself. So I think you need to, you're expected to have all of that when you walk in the room.
To be a serious actor, there's some reality people that might get a chance.
Right, right.
Here and there.
And those aren't people that I would be really interested in.
Right. No chance of a long career that way.
Yes.
This is from Facebook. What homework can an actor do when trying to figure out who is a good manager or agent?
Well, you can figure out who's legit by certainly just going on the IMDb and looking.
Some people may not know.
The IMDb is the Internet Movie Database, and it's what we now, most of us in this industry, all use. It's a prescription service, and if you pay for it, you can look up who represents who. So if you want to follow people's careers, say, well, who represents Leonardo DiCaprio, you can look up who represents Leonardo DiCaprio, but I would definitely look at people's client lists as I was considering them to represent me. That being said, we all start somewhere, right? We all start somewhere. So, you know, there was a time when I didn't have any street cred, and just like a lot of you in here, and if you find somebody who's passionate and excited and gets you and you like them and you feel comfortable with them, and that's always the best bet, is somebody who you think is going to hustle and build your chair.
Okay, this is from Facebook. In your experience, are most auditions self-tape or in person? Do you think self-tapes will become more prevalent over time?
I hate to answer this question on camera. Can we turn it off? I think the self-tape is becoming very prevalent. I think getting you in the room is always the best option. That being said, some actors do better with self-tapes because they have the power to manipulate the film and the take and what you're going to see and the whatever. So then I have other actors who light up a room. They walk in the door and you go, who is that? And so I think there's advantages for certain actors, and I don't think this is like one size fits all kinds of question. Do I think that there will be more self-tapes? Absolutely, 100%, because that's what the casting people are showing to their producers anyway. So you're just saving them time. So yes, I think self-tapes are very valuable. The trick is to make sure they're getting seen. So hopefully your people will be following up and saying, did you watch it? What did you think of her? What did you like the performance? Did you not?
Do actors still need reels? And what makes a good reel or a bad
100%. A reel is an imperative tool for me, especially when you start getting into the level of offer-only talent. I think maybe more managers are doing it now. I've been doing it for years. I do my own reels in-house. And I try to tailor them to fit what we're trying to go after. So, for example, I have a client yesterday. We were like, the agent called me and says, I don't think the reel's light enough for this half-hour comedy. It's really heavy on the drama. And I go, wait a minute. I've got six other credits that are a little older that'll lighten up the tape. We shuffled it all around. And then by the time we got it done, the casting said, yeah, we're going diverse.
Moral of the story is why bother? In terms of putting together a reel, there used to be the old thing of the montage at the beginning.
Yes. Yeah. No more.
No, don't do that.
No,
right?
Right. Don't right. do that. No montage.
Don't want to see you in all the different looks. No.
No, and I don't have time for it. Let's get to the meat scene and put your best work first. Don't go by what's necessary that are most current. Put your best work at the front of the tape because that's what's going to sell me. I mean, if you're going to grab my attention, grab it in the first 3 minutes. Otherwise, I'm going to turn it off. So, like, put your best scenes first.
And length overall?
5 minutes tops.
Yeah, there's people with attention spans.
Yeah, 5 minutes tops. Sometimes when you get to a certain level and you've got so much different stuff that you want to need to show, you can go maybe to 7. But that's going to be rare for most people. I think 5 minutes is a good thing.
Great. This is from Nicholas, who's here. If you want to pursue multiple roles within the industry, act, produce, direct, what is the best way to market oneself beyond pursuing your strongest strength?
Ooh, that's a good question. First of all, you're lucky. I think we're now living in an industry where you can do that a lot more easily than you used to be able to. It used to be that you were a director, you were an actor, you were a writer. You know, again, I go back to Bradley Cooper, who I just thought was just genius in Star is Born. I mean, he wrote that. He spent 3 years honing his ability to sing.
And also against everybody's advice, telling him not to
yes.
do that.
Yes, and I mean, I happen to really think what they did is, I'm just kind of in awe of that film, and those people who did it. I don't know the answer to your question is what's the best. I think try to put yourself in the best place in each scenario. If you're going to write, find yourself a nice writing assistant job if you can. Put it in, and put yourself in that place, and then continue to pursue your acting career. And you know, put yourself in the best places you can be. Again, find those people that inspire you that are going to help lift you up, and you're going to help lift them up. Get out there and do that, and that. And then just follow the path. That's, you know, it'll all come if you put yourself in the right place at the right time.
Which segues nicely into final thoughts, Kyle. Anything you want to share or anything we didn't cover? Anything you want to leave people with?
I felt like I really covered a lot.
You
today.
Did. you're going to be tired. We got our money's worth, our bottle of water's worth.
I mean, the best... How much was that water? I can't emphasize enough to listen to your instincts. I just listen to your instincts, and if you're, and I feel, I don't believe in a lot of spiritual stuff, but I do feel like the universe sends us in the right directions if we're paying attention. So I think just pay attention. And this is not just for acting, it's for life. Surround yourself with great people that inspire you in your life, and it'll all come back around, and you'll find yourself in a good place at the end of it, hopefully.
Thank you. Thank you, Kyle Fritz.